pleased to welcome everyone here this afternoon. My name is Dr. Philip Phillips, and I'm the Associate Dean of the University Honors College. I'd like to recognize our very own Dean, Dr. John Vile, who is in attendance here and gives his blessing to this occasion. I'm very pleased to introduce our speaker today. Odie Lindsey is a senior lecturer at Vanderbilt Center for Medicine, Health, and Society, which is an amazing interdisciplinary program at Vanderbilt. I believe it is now the largest undergraduate major, is that right? And it also has a graduate program. It's one of the things that's really interesting about it is that the people who are involved in the Center for Medicine, Health, and Society come from a variety of disciplinary backgrounds, and some from an unusual combination of disciplinary backgrounds. For example, the director, Jonathan Metzel, has a doctorate in American literature and also has an MD. I believe that's correct. And there are other people who have those sorts of combinations who are medical doctors, who are research scientists, people who are in the humanities or social sciences, who deal with all aspects of those things, medicine, health, and society. And if you're unfamiliar with the program, I would encourage you to look it up because they also sponsor a number of very interesting programs and their publications are prolific. So we're very pleased to have Odie here with us today. He earned his MA in Southern Studies from the University of Mississippi and his Master of Fine Arts in Writing from the School of the Art Institute of Chicago. A combat veteran, his creative and scholarly work often examines the cross currents of war, gender, sexuality, and the South, as well as the role of the body in Southern literature and culture. At Vanderbilt, he teaches courses on medicine and literature, health and the body, and documenting the body. His writing appears in such publications as The Best American Short Stories and the Iowa Review, among many others. His most recent collection of stories entitled We Come to Our Senses, which features men and women directly and indirectly affected by combat and the ways in which war touches their lives back home, was published by W.W. Norton and Company in 2016. The topic of his talk today is Writing the War at Home, Postwar Fiction and the Legacy of Trauma. Please join me in welcoming Odie Lindsey.
Well, I sure am glad to be here. A smart man would stop after that introduction. I've never been accused of being smart, so I'm going to go on. I am a part of a wonderful department at Vanderbilt. I've had a chance recently to read from my work. I get to teach incredible students. Rarely do I get the opportunity to come in here as a guy who writes fiction and who writes fiction about war and who, by writing fiction, spends an extraordinarily and ridiculous amount of time in tiny spaces looking at a screen, fumbling with sentences. I don't get to come in and speak with people and sort of pull back the curtain about that process, what goes into it, and how my teaching, my scholarly work, my military experience, and my strange obsession with sentences all come together. So I'm grateful for that. I'm grateful to be with y'all. Of note, I've just decided to actually ditch the laptop. I'm going straight with paper. I was telling Dean Phillips that I've attempted and I teach with PowerPoint, I teach with electronic things, but at the end of the day, I'm an anxious person, and there's nothing worse for an anxious person than to have the PowerPoint go wrong, or maybe pull up your personal email. I don't know, I'm the guy that happens to, so I'm just gonna yap. I also dig the conversational thing. I wanna present information to you in a way that I promise is a bit rehearsed. It's not too loose, but that allows us a bit of give and take, and the good news is, two good things for y'all. One, I'll eventually stop. And two, if you have questions or if I miss something, I want you to please feel free to ask me. insults. Maybe don't do that till I've left the room. But yeah, I'm just gonna roll with the anxiety, as it were, and then we'll visit afterwards. The good thing for me, by the way, is that you're sort of captives. I guess you can get up and walk out of here, but I think you have to be here. So cheers to me. This is great. So my talk today, I want to speak with you all. I don't have my glasses. I can't see the clock. It will go on point. About three things. I want to break down sort of a scholarly framework that might apply to how we write the war at home. And again, the title that I proposed here, Writing the War at Home, Postwar Fiction and the Legacy of Trauma, has to do with what it's like to not only be a soldier, but to come home, to re-examine the war story, to examine the culture that contributes to that, to re-examine what it means to be a soldier, what we think of, who has a narrative, how we explore narratives and our cultural relationship to that. And the three parts will be sort of the scholarly framework. I want to give you a little bit of grounding that I think is in dialogue with my work, a little bit about my process, and finally, a joke. And in the interest of drama, I'm lying, because I'm going to go with the joke first. The thing about the joke is you should never open with a joke. It's like the oldest cliche in the world. About 6 months ago, I had to give a talk to a few of my colleagues, and I don't sleep well because I'm anxious. You can tell. And I've already told you. And I'm sitting there, what am I going to talk about? How do I open? And I knew that the one way that I couldn't open was with a joke. And they said, that's exactly what I have to do. The problem is I only know two jokes. I can't retain them. And they're both from second grade level, from small children, and that's okay, they're good. So let's start with this joke, and it'll come back. I promise you, it will come back, but let's start with this joke. A three-legged dog walks into a bar and says, I'm looking for the man who shot my paw. Yeah? Oh, come on, anyway, a three-legged dog, maybe I'm just not delivering it. Maybe I need to be a second grader. Imagine you're a second grader. Three-legged dog walks into a bar, says, I'm looking for the man who shot my paw. All right, so moving on. My biography, as was mentioned, I served in actually the first Gulf War, 1991, Operation Desert Storm. I was in the Army, more specifically, I was in the Army Reserve. More specifically, I was entering my sophomore year of college, and my unit was called up. Because of the specialization of this unit, a combat engineer unit, we were attached to the 82nd Airborne out of Fort Bragg, North Carolina. And I bring that up only because that is a combat forward, combat intense, highly specialized outfit. And for a reservist who's 19, doing college-y things that college-y people do at 19, it was quite a shift to spend some time amongst airborne infantry and other types of sort of gung-ho folks. It was good. It gave me a liminal sort of, I was in a space where I had insight into some areas that not all reservists were able to gather. Deployed for a year, came back to college, down the, or up the road or east of the road or northeast in Knoxville, and lost it. Had a horrible year. Did terrible things to my body, did terrible things to relationships, did terrible things in school, didn't go to school really. And then all of a sudden one day said, wait a second, all I have to do is show up, read a book, maybe listen to some guy for an hour. There are worse things that could happen to you having just come back from a combat deployment. So it all worked out, but what stuck with me was that strange period of coming home and this notion of sort of being lost, being in this dark space, because that didn't jibe with my experience necessarily. But when I talked to colleagues, some other people got lost in this dark space. And my solution was to get back to school, to get back to work, to never speak of it. And in fact, I met friends, and for years, I never even told them I was in the military. As I developed as a writer, songwriter, fiction writer, I didn't write about that experience. There was nothing to write about. In comparison to, let's say, the war narrative that I'm familiar with. So I come home, that happened, did get my graduate work, some graduate work at the University of Mississippi, studying Southern culture. MFA at the School of the Art Institute. Taught a bunch of places, every place from Austin Community College veterans to Fisk University to art school, and now at Vanderbilt. I'm so pleased to have a book out about this, but that's not why we're here. Maybe. No, we're not here for that. We're here. Let me ask you a question. How many people in this room are veterans? Okay. That's kind of what I expected. Thank you for. And how many people's immediate family members are veterans? That's more than I expected. Percentage-wise, do we have any idea of what the percentage of Americans are who serve or who have deployed? Yeah, less than 1%, right? Fewer than 1%. Now, that's a good thing through some lens, right? We don't want it to be higher. I'd like it to be 0%. But in the other way, it puts war and our associations with war or combat or what that means, it puts it at a remove, right? And so we often have a hard time going into it. Or we're stuck with specific narratives. And we use those or we lean against those. And that's kind of where I want to get to. Now, again, the three things, scholarly sort of framework, my personal process and the joke, and you already know the joke. I might need to tell it again. Scholarship-wise, I wanted to draw on a friend of mine, a colleague, Kenneth McLeish. He's actually been a speaker here. I realize that I'm not only cribbing his work, but I'm cribbing his talk. But he is at Vanderbilt. He wrote a book called Making War at Fort Hood, Life and Uncertainty in a Military Community. And it's a book that had I not been working with him, I would love, I would sit here and speak about. I would champion it. Ken's an anthropologist. He studied Fort Hood in Texas, but mostly he did ethnographic work. He talked to soldiers. He tried to discover relationships about the body at war, what war does to the body, the post-war experience on the body, but also the notion of war and how it impacts culture at large. And three things I'll take away from that that I want to talk about. This notion of war as an exceptional process, as being a not normalized process. Two, the notion of trauma versus vulnerability. And for our purposes, I want to add this sort of corollary effect of war on the larger community. The first one, this notion of war as this exceptional feat, as this rarity, as this last-ditch process. Of that, McLeish says, and of larger narratives, and by narratives I don't mean fictional or fictive narratives, I mean narratives that we tell ourselves about war, that culturally we espouse. In these stories, war's productive and destructive violence, the empowerment, construction, and shaping of the soldier, his wearing down, injury, and death, and the terrorizing, maiming, and extermination of civilians is the exception rather than the rule. All the harm that comes with war is cast as tragedy or side effect, as something that should not have happened. And what McLeish says with respect to this topic, writing the war at home, post-war fiction, is that it actually is not exceptional. He says when we think about it, even the current sort of engagements that we have, in the current Gulf Wars, initial folks were deployed in 2002, 2003. That's a long time. Many of you, this has been the bulk, perhaps, of your lives. This has been going on. But Ken also would speak about the fact that even when not at war, bodies are training for war. We have plenty of military armed services who are going through training, who are going through basic training. Policies are made. Arms deals are made. It's estimated that 70% of the countries on the planet have some footprint of special forces activity, U.S. special forces activity, whether that's advisory or a boots on the ground sort of situation. He would argue even that as we think about bases, Fort Hood, Fort Bragg, Fort Campbell, that extended community operates within a war setting, right? And so therefore, it's kind of nice to think this is a last ditch thing, but it's often in perpetuity. War making is in perpetuity. We're constantly readying for that process. And funny, I was at a conference recently with a bunch of war writers, all veteran guys, and somebody brought up the notion that until 2 or 3 years ago, there was a very hot term known as the endless war. and the New York Times to fiction, whoever, say, oh, endless war. But even that has exhausted itself. Nobody uses that anymore because the war has gone on so long that that's lost its sort of cultural cachet. There's no clause to that anymore. And so that's one thing that I want us to think about from a scholarly sort of framework. Another thing that Ken talks about, Dr. McLeish, is the notion of trauma. And I've used that word in my own title here, Postwar Fiction and the Legacy of Trauma. But when it comes to war writing or cultural product or even the day-to-day of the experience, I think it may be the wrong word. And I agree with Ken that trauma is a condition that's often diagnosed or treated with sort of a quantitative or biomedical sense, right? We're going to look for the cause, and we're going to treat that specific cause, and it's going to go away. And PTSD, we often hear thrown around, right? PTSD, post-traumatic stress disorder, as this term that is this sort of medical treatable term. Things aren't that easy. As McLeish says, trauma posits a clear, linear, causal link between present suffering and a specific past event. It emphasizes individual psychic experience and insists that such an experience requires verification, description, and elaboration, right? We can find it, we can name it, we can tend to it, we can cure it. It's fixed at a certain point in time. And what Ken suggests, Dr. McLeish, I keep calling him Ken, I forget, we're filming me being so casual with my colleague who worked tremendously hard on this book, is that he suggests that the lens through which we might view post-war fiction or personal and cultural legacy is through a notion of vulnerability. A vulnerability instead of trauma, right? A vulnerability works during war. And he talks about, for example, if someone's wearing a sappy plate, if you're wearing armor, not only does that protect you, but it makes you firmly aware that your body is fragile, that someone is engaging you as a target, and that you're mortal, right? That's just one small example. He also talks about what he calls the lived affect of war, post-war, affect with an A, in that how behavior is modified, muscle memory, memory loss, polytrauma, which is a term that often in the VA or in other situations is used to identify just that, polytrauma. Multiple symptoms, disparate elements that can't quite be treated, but we throw a lot of things at it and hope to sort of calm that down. For me, fireworks. Terrified of fireworks, which is weird because then I say they're fireworks and I'm fine. But initially, there's something there that tends to linger with us, and it may be fixed, it may not be fixed. But a vulnerability, he says, vulnerability does not demand a before and after or the exception of a disrupted psyche. It signals a condition that is ongoing or even permanent. The always precarious and susceptible nature of the human organism itself. And so now and again, I'll intersperse with a tiny war story. Here's a war story. I went to graduate school, MFA, with this guy. He was a painter. He had also served in Operation Desert Storm. Great painter, great guy, had substance abuse problems. He had been through a divorce. He had some issues with depression. He was always rubbing on himself, rubbing on his skin. I said, what's going on, man? And he swore all this stuff is post-war, right? I don't know. I take him at his word. I said, what's up with your skin? I said, what does it feel? He said, I've got this thing. I said, what does it feel like? He said, it felt like thousands of splinters that were on fire just beneath the surface of his skin. In other words, he had what is called Gulf War Syndrome. Gulf War Syndrome. But the thing is, this was 2003 when I met him. And Gulf War Syndrome wasn't even recognized as a syndrome until 2008. So in other words, he's been dealing with this for 12 years, and it wasn't until 5 years later, 17 years after his deployment, that he was able to even be formally acknowledged in the medical community. At that time, instead of polytrauma, by the way, they refer to it as chronic sort of multi-symptomatic issues. So there and again, he was living the affect of war. He was vulnerable to the situation in myriad ways, but the trauma itself had not even been sort of formalized as something that needed to be diagnosed. Now, when we combine this notion of unexceptionalism, this recurrent this perpetuity of war or war making with vulnerability. I also, as someone who studies how to tell a war story, a post-war story, look at a sort of corollary impact or after effect of war. And by that, I mean the way that the war ripples out into the community, the way in which war impacts non-combatant bodies or non-militarized bodies, how war culture impacts who we are, our sense of identity. That could be my Uber driver who's at Fort Campbell and earning a couple bucks on the weekend. It could be the VA clinic. It could be my neighbor. I might speak about him. In this case, my book, Cultural Product, the way that cultural product is produced from this, right? We all have sort of ties, even if we're not certain of what our tie-ins are. Now, again, my book is vehicle. Forgive me. I'm not trying to be selfish. I'm certainly not here to promote a book, but I've spent a ridiculous amount of time with this thing. So when I move into that space, I dream about the hundreds of hours spent in this converted laundry room in like Austin, Texas. I dream about when I sold everything and moved to Spain and then Morocco, but I didn't really go out. I just sat in a room and typed, right? So point being, I'm so intimately aware of this that I want to talk about it and how I came to that process as a second component here. It also is informed by my scholarly work, my teaching, my research, and my personal info. Again, I mentioned my experience way back when, my sort of post-war muck up there, the silence with friends, grad school. In 2003, post 9/11, when troops were being deployed to Iraq, I lost it again, despite all my silence and keeping it together. I had been not writing about war, but what I saw on television was a new generation of 19-year-olds deploying to the exact same space where I had deployed, being sent there by a president with the exact same last name in order to fight a leader, the same guy. And I'm in Chicago in this tiny apartment watching this, and it was like this weird rerun, you know, and I decided it was time to engage this, and I unspooled. I just started making notes. I was writing everything, single space, 25, 30, 40 pages, everything that was on TV, any memory I had, there's a bee in my apartment, whatever. I just decided I need to start by auditing this information, gathering this information, trying to figure out what happened. In my experience, and trying to figure out its relationship in a post-war setting to a new war breaking out. I knew about war stories, and what I knew is that I didn't have one based upon the war stories that I was familiar with. I had deployed, I had come home, I was fine. And so I thought, what happened? What's in there that's complicated by that? And so I'll ask questions. In fact, I'll stop and ask you, what does a war story look like? What does a war story look like to you? Anyone. It's okay, you could say. I mean, look at me. I'm a fool. You, nothing you say will be any more ridiculous than me standing here. What makes up a war story? Come to mind. Anything you've seen. Yes.
An act of heroism.
Act of heroism. Okay. What else? Yeah. I'm sorry?
People dying.
Okay.
Bodily harm, injury. Sort of macabre sense of humor.
Okay.
Often it either condemns or not verifies, but...
glorifies?
Yeah, glorifies the... reasons that the war happened and the very fact that people are going off to fight.
Sure. And when you say people, who's fighting in these acts of heroism, bodily harm, contempt, all this stuff? Who's fighting?
It's always dudes,
right? Okay. Yeah. What does a soldier look like was my next question. You can come up with whatever definition is filling your mind, but arguably most folks, it's guys, right? It's guys. Largely also in terms of race, ethnicity, what type of guys?
White guys,
sure. And so we're filling in the existing blank of what we see as a war story. That's what I'm filling in. Bodily harm, acute engagement, weaponization, tragedy, macabre humor, honor and or critique. All of these things make up the war story, right? So I'm thinking about this at last when I'm unspooling, and I'm like, how do I get into that? That's not my story, so I must not have a story. My colleagues must not have stories. Anybody who doesn't engage in that space must not have a story, and therefore, we need to just move on. I could move on. A second thing happened right around that time. I'm thinking about the South, and as Dean Phillips mentioned, a lot of my work is set in the South. It has its own distinct relationship to militarization and the body. And I'm teaching a class at Loyola in Chicago. I'm teaching a Faulkner story, Dry September. And I know that thing, and I know all the components of storytelling. I know what it says. I can do all this. I can tell you about the writing style. And I have this student raise her hand, and she basically asked me a question about what was off the page. And if you don't know the story, it involves a veteran and this group of men, white men in a barbershop in the sort of Jim Crow era South, and they get a rumor that an African-American man has touched a white woman, and they go out. There's this sort of mobilization, this strike force, and they go out and they find the guy. And it turns out that he had not done anything, but just on the rumor, they end up killing him. And this woman asked me, how did that come together? What's the glue behind that mobilization, behind that violence, behind these men saying, come on, who are you? This sort of challenging of same kind of guys to get up and go do this. And I said, I didn't have an answer, right? I didn't have an answer. And so making a bad decision on top of a bad decision, I decided to go back to school for a second master's degree, in this case, studying the South, studying war literature, studying militarization of the South, asking what is a war story. I wanted to know who's a soldier, what is the South, and how did that culture of militarization come to identify my notion of what a soldier is. So ended up in Oxford, reading war lit, studying the South. Look at me, look how, this is modern right here. I know this seems like a throwback thing for me to have a stapled 3 sheets of paper, but whatever. But what I did find working with some scholars and studying history and studying militarization and studying literature, of course, a lot of the things that we might describe that have to do with the war story, a lot of violence, a lot of physical trauma, a lot of sort of blood, the notion of a lost cause. This landscape is often decorated with statues that honor broken bodies, namely men, right? The cultural critic Richard Slotkin, an historian, would call this notion regeneration through violence. There's something about a broken masculinity that becomes regenerated through this representation. The same thing, because often when we talk about these war stories, what happens? There's a guy crying, there's a sad soldier, something happens that kind of tears him up, and then we have this relationship to his emotions, and that's fine. I started looking around. I'm a jerk because I've been out here a few times, but again, we all know that I sit in my place. I haven't been out here enough, so forgive me if this applies here, but when I was in Franklin recently, on the town square in Franklin, what demarcates that? A tall statue with a marble soldier on the stop, on the port arms, right? That's across the South, thousands of statues like that everywhere. In fact, they're kind of controversial right now. We talk about bodies and representations and what to do when certain bodies are represented more than others. If you go downtown to the court, to the state capitol right now, there are no fewer than 6 memorials to Civil War soldiers. There's one now memorial to Vietnam soldiers that involves African Americans. It's across the street. Texas is the same. You go to a hippie town like Asheville, same kind of thing, right? These things are everywhere. These memorialize our identity. What we learn about when you read books like Karen Cox's Dixie's Daughters is that actually these statues were put up between 1890 and 1920, largely, thousands of them, commissioned often by ladies' memorial associations around the South. And there's this weird dynamic there of female sort of agency or empowerment and cultural product that's produced, and it's all sort of produced with this one thing in mind, and that is representations of what we now know as the lost cause. Fallen heroes, fallen men, sort of broken Civil War. You get it. Why am I stuttering here? I know what I'm talking about. Representations of manhood, let's say, that were put across, and this rehabilitative nature. Antebellum South is a beautiful place. There was a cause involved. We were broken on our own soil, but this leads to what the historian Charles Reagan Wilson refers to as the civil religion of the South, the lost cause, and this rehabilitation of sort of white heteromasculinity and this sort of invasion that took that away. Now, we know things are more complicated than that, but that's the landscape in here, which is why a lot of people often say that the South lost the war, but it won the peace, right? This is something that we hear now and again. So I'm thinking about this. How does this impact my identity? How does this impact my war story? How does this impact our cultural war story? How does this impact these narratives that even when we describe them are kind of the same? Some similar episodes. And I return to my big unspooling, my notes, because I still don't know how to write about it. I still don't know what happened. And I see amongst all these notes, everything I could remember, a little bitty thing I had watched on TV, I saw a name, Shoshana Johnson. And nobody in here knows who Shoshana Johnson is, correct? Okay. I didn't either. She was one little note. But I thought, who is that? And I went back and looked, and she was the first African-American female prisoner of war. And I remember when this invasion is unfolding and I'm watching it on television, a little bitty picture came on the bottom of CNN and it said this woman had been taken, captured. Now she had been, I think she was a truck driver if I could recall, and her convoy went into an urban area. They were attacked. She took fire. She was shot in the leg. She returned fire. Ultimately, she was taken prisoner. She was held hostage. She was presented on Iraqi state TV and back here at home, right? And what I recalled about her was that she was going to get an honorable discharge. She was going to get a Purple Heart. She was not going to get a combat patch. Because of her gender, she was not going to get combat pay. She was not going to have access to certain things that other bodies have access to. And I thought, man, that's extraordinary. And I started wondering, I actually audited my own memory, and I realized I served with a ton of females. And you know what? I got a combat patch, because again, I was attached to the airborne. They didn't. I got extra pay that I assumed they didn't. I didn't even ask them, but what was even stranger for me, given how we fill in the blanks, I didn't even remember. I had done them the disservice of not even remembering them when I was remembering my own combat experience. I was so accustomed to who a soldier is and to what a war experience is that I put them aside. And that was problematic, A, but it also led to the questions that involved this notion of post-war storytelling or revisiting a space as a writer or as a thinker. And some of the questions I thought, what happened to the females? What happens when a female soldier comes home to a space defined by warrior men on statues everywhere? What happens when a queer soldier comes home to a space of intolerance? What happens when soldiers come home to a culture where they're not represented? We can also think about this. Led me to, you know, if you think about the post-World War II, maybe you've heard of the double victory movement. African-American soldiers coming home having fought Hitler, right? Having fought against racism and systemic sort of prejudice, and they come home and not only did they engage in our space here, the South and the nation, in that same sort of segregation and violence, but so we now know when we look at bodies and spectacle lynchings and violence against African Americans, soldiers were far more likely to be the subject of that violence, of race-based violence, than non-soldiers, right? They represent a sort of authority, perhaps, or an ambition, or a dissatisfaction, or again, part of this double V, double victory, victory abroad, victory at home campaign. That's a complication of bodies maybe not being represented, right? And so I thought, I've got to explore that. I've got to explore the impact of these sort of memorials around here. Can I capture the mundane post-war vulnerability, the day-to-day, the people whose uncles served, and who somehow they just have an odd relationship to him. And this notion of vulnerability is applied to even the most removed non-military member. How does war impact those of us who haven't served, who don't think we have a formal connection? And I'll pause here. Asking questions is not bad. It's one thing I tell my students the first day, by the way, I don't care what your political stripe is, right, left, center. I just need you to be better at it than what you are. And the way that you get to that is to asking questions. And I also have a little bit of frustration when we tend to have it seems that culturally we're in this space where we only want to hold on to one narrative. You're this or you're that. And I think we're far more complex than that. So forgive me if I'm raising these things. It's not really to force some sort of agenda. It's to ask us to come to terms with the truth. And that leads me to the third part of this, which is my ability to audit the truth. An ability to look at the truth, to look at those sentences, to look at your beliefs, to look at your representations and say, how much of this is real and can I come at it from a different point of view? Can I hold competing truths together in an effort to fully understand a subject? Tim O'Brien, many of you have probably read the things they carried at some point, right? And he starts How to Tell a True War Story with three syllables. This is true, period. And then he starts a new paragraph. And he says, the truths are contradictory. It can be argued, for instance, that war is grotesque, but in truth, war is also beauty. For all its horror, you can't help but gape at the awful majesty of combat. And so I'm looking at remove, and I'm looking at vulnerability, and I'll tell you, here's another one of my war stories. I'm on a plane to Jacksonville a few years ago, Jacksonville, Florida. It's a Southwest flight. I can tell sitting in the crowded gate area that this thing is going to get gnarly because everybody's got large carry-on bags, and we're going to stuff them, and it's going to be this, like, death match to get that space, to get on there first, and man, I can't bear not having my large carry-on bag with me, right? And as you know, I'm an anxious guy, so I'm sitting around, I'm like, oh no, I'm in, like, group three. Never going to get space. And somebody announces, if we have any members of the military, retired military, would you like to board first? And never in my life have I ever even done anything like that, right? And I said, hell yes. And I walked up there with my bag and my VA card, and I got on first, and I got my bag up there, and sure enough, this thing is crowded, and people are pushing and shoving and breaking and, you know, shoving the thing up and having to take their bags out, and they're not happy. And we get to Jacksonville, and this brood is really not happy, and I think the plane's AC may be out. I might be lying because I am a dramatist, but it felt that way in my memory. And so we get there, we get to Jacksonville, and as soon as, you know, when you land and boom, the thing goes, everybody's hopping up, jockeying for position, getting their stuff, they're getting out their stuff, and the captain comes on the intercom and he says, I need everybody to please hold tight for 10 minutes. And curses, shoves, pushing, no way, cursing the captain. He says, please, y'all, we need 10 minutes. Please look out the window. We got a soldier coming home. And there's a family out there, and it's a mom and two kids and grandparents, and they're dressed in black, and they're sitting there, and somebody's wheeling out a coffin that has a flag on top of it, right? Because there's a big VA cemetery in Jacksonville. And all of us start bawling. Every one of us starts crying because we're fools and we're pushing on each other. And so that kind of thing is the kind of story that I want us to explore. I want us to look at the day-to-day, quasi-mundane, and how being a fraction away from that sort of emotional situation, auditing the truth, looking for those spaces. I want us to know why, to cite another war story, and I swear I'll stop soon, a diminutive evangelical grocery clerk from Short Gap, West Virginia, ends up doing the double rocket, pointing at a line of naked and bruised bodies in Abu Ghraib prison that are fouled by their own fluids and have bags over their head. One of them is made to hold his penis at extension, and that photo goes all around the world. And then she goes back to Short Gap, West Virginia, and she's living in that same trailer where she was before, only she's sort of this demon component of what war does to people. That's a story. That's a heavy story. Now, I would skip on, but you know what? I got a good story. I can't just do that. I teach medicine and literature, and I teach war literature, and man, I'm going to start teaching jokes if I can ever remember more than two. But I got a good war story. My grandfather comes back from World War II. He's fought in the Pacific, and he's fought in both theaters, and he comes home, and he's got a child, and he says, I got to get out of here immediately to my grandmother because he's never seen this country. He doesn't have any money. But he gets his duffel bag, and he gets what he can, and he travels, and he's in Birmingham, Alabama, by the way, that's where he's from, and he travels all over the space, and he gets to California, and then he gets back, and he gets to the Grand Canyon, and he runs out of dough. He's got zero dough left, and he knows, though, if he puts on his uniform, it'll be easier to hitchhike. So he does. He pulls it out of the bag. He slaps it on, stands on the side of the Grand Canyon. He's just full of awe and majesty. Holds out his thumb, and the first car that comes along are his next-door neighbors back in Birmingham, and they take him all the way back. That's a war story, right? End on a high note. Teaching war. again, to go to this panel of war writers I was on. The thing is, we just need to audit those truths. War is not always hell, right? It's not always hell. Other things that we were talking about, a bunch of veterans are not always heroes. Veterans are not all messed up. Some of them are awesome. They come home and they just go to head companies. They seek out. They are ambitious people. They're not always broken. In my case, again, they're not always guys. We know that. They're not always straight or anything else, right? They don't need to be treated the same way. The other thing about listening to veterans, those of you who have family or teaching veterans or talking to, let them take the lead. It's funny, when you go in to teach a veteran in a creative writing program, if y'all walked in and you're not vets, I'm gonna say, do this, you read James Joyce, read all this, read that stuff. A veteran, often you say, you've gotta read Tim O'Brien, you've gotta read All Quiet on the Western Front, you give them this list of war books. When we see our veterans, we might ask them, have you seen American Sniper? Have you seen that? Why don't let them talk about what they want to talk about? And if somebody wants to talk about Chris Kyle, then you talk about Chris Kyle, but don't limit them to that space. Now the last thing, my goodness, I know I've got to get us out of here. I got to come back to the joke. Because the thing about the joke is, if we take away the thousands of hours that have to do with precision of language, no, we don't have to take away 1,000. Here's the joke. A three-legged dog walks into a bar and says, I'm looking for the man who shot my paw. Now, if I were to say to you, a dog missing a leg walks into a bar, that's a different thing. A dog missing a leg, dogs like legs. They often engage with them in romantic practices. So a dog missing a leg could be a completely different thing than a three-legged dog, right? So language does have to be precise in that audit of truth. But really, when you think about that joke, or when I was thinking about it, laying awake, it's like it's not even a joke, right? It's a statement. In fact, it's a play on words, and therefore it's a pun. So let's just start with putting it out of the category of joke, because that's not appropriate. And then I started thinking, well, it's a one-liner. But I bumped my paw. And then I thought, no, it's a two-liner. Wait, it's a three-liner, because at first it's a play on words, right? It's a one-liner. Two, it follows this existing trope of narratives. A guy walks into a bar, jokes. A guy walks into a bar. A horse walks into a bar. It is sort of recurrent element. And third, there's a cultural implication to this joke. And in this case, it's the search for vengeance. And we might even start there, this poor joke. Poor second grade joke, right? Now, where does that dog live? I'm looking for the man who shot my paw. Arguably the South, maybe the West, but certainly he's regionally specific, right? That relies, again, on stereotype, arguably cliche, maybe not, but what we know. We supply that information. It's the backdrop of the joke itself. I mean, they probably, this is so unfair. I'm going to pick a town. Anybody from Hartford, Connecticut? I don't know anybody in Hartford, Connecticut walks into a bar looking for the man who shot my paw, right? So yeah, we definitely are feeling, I mean, they have their version of it, but this is a Southern thing. Now, if we think about that dog and we de-anthropomorphize it, which may or may not be a term, but don't look it up on Wikipedia. If we make it not a dog and we make it back into a human, well, what type of human are we talking about? Is it a gender-wise? Man. Any guess at race or ethnicity? I don't know. I'm going to say a white guy, but we'll just stick with the guys, right? But we definitely have this notion of masculinity. And by him walking in and looking for the man who shot my paw, we also have this burden then of generational masculinity, right? And that's incorporated with honor, with pride, retribution, cultural potency, the fulfillment of a masculine code versus a penalty of cultural impotence. We've got a reification of masculine violence, performance, and ultimately spectacle. Whether you're looked at by the culture at large, whether it's the statue at which you are supposed to measure up against, right? The implication here of the consequences that you have to avenge a broken masculinity, lest your masculinity become broken. All of it in behalf of this sort of noble affair. I'm going to redeem my father's loss in front of everybody socially, and I'm in an honorable space to do that, right? It's an exceptional condition, a last resort. It's memorialized and thus socialized as part of the post-war setting. an event happened, violence, and I'm here to start it up again. And to an extent, when you're telling a war story or a post-war story, there's nothing sort of more ripe for examination. And I better stop, because I see that the clock is at 10 till. Anyway, any questions about that joke? About post-war literature? About studying the body? Yes.
What's the second joke you know?
Man, I knew you were going to ask that. Let me get it straight. Where is it? Did you hear about the two televisions that got married?
Reception was great.
Yeah, why don't bust me? Don't keep it to yourself, man. Oh, yeah, the wedding was awful, but the reception was outstanding. Yes.
What was that?
No, don't worry. But then, I don't know. I don't know. I don't want to. I'm being filmed here. This is for posterity. I'm going to come up with a third joke sometime. Other stuff, yeah.
What was the title of your book again?
We Come to Our Senses. Sure. Anyway, other questions? Anyone? Well, I appreciate you being held here. And thank you for your ear. Thank you for letting me ramble through jokes, for presenting to you on paper. And thanks again to Dean Phillips. Take care.